Yo, this is Lefty. So, a couple months ago, I told someone in the comments section of one of my videos, when it was I want to say it was for the Anthony Joshua Molina fight, the aftermath of it. Someone wanted me to go over Anthony Joshua in a complete fighter profile, documenting all of his fights all the way back, basically all 19 of them. So I told him I'd do it. I'm a little late on it, actually a lot late on it, about a month late, but it's done. So this is what that video is about now. Real quick, I can't express more that I can't express more gratitude for everybody following, commenting, viewing. Pete Long, my most dedicated listener, watcher, much respect. Couple other guys too, but thanks for everyone that supports me. Now the channel's doing good. I believe we're 17-9-2. So it's not a bad record, especially with the way that sometimes I pick underdogs, and there's been a lot of 50-50 fights, 50-50 type fights. That's not a bad record. I don't think it is, especially I want to say that we've had four or five split decisions, or split decisions or decisions that were within one round that didn't go our way. So instead of 17-9, we could easily be 23-3. If one judge from each fight decided to give it to the guy that we're favoring. So, once again, you're never going to get all the decisions, and as much as you crunch tape, because I crunch a lot, it's just not everything's going to work out for you. So, other than that, this is the Anthony Joshua fighter profile. How about that decision? Danny Garcia and Thurman, I want to say 40% of the viewers from Showtime or CBS, whatever, gave it to Thurman, 60%, or no, 60% to Thurman, 40% to Garcia. It's a fight that could have went either way for me. Guys that were backing Thurman feel like it's a close but decisive decision. And I didn't quite see it that way. Thurman, he put a bad taste in my mouth. Going into the fight, I think I'm going to adjust the way that I do these videos, because just because a guy is a favorite and the most likely outcome is that he's going to win, that doesn't mean that you should bet on him all the time. That fight could have easily gone to Garcia if, the one judge that had it 115-113 went for Garcia instead of Thurman. So Garcia was paying off, and I thought this was a 50-50 fight, and the fact that it was a split decision, validates that opinion that I had. But we're talking 2-to-1 odds on Garcia in a split decision fight. So, even though I thought Thurman going into the fight, I remember on Monday or Tuesday, about a week ago, I was thinking, man, the most likely outcome is probably a Thurman decision. However, if I'm putting money on it, I'm betting Garcia because of the odds. Because the odds for Thurman were that pretty much if you bet 10 bucks, you're going to get like 6 or 7 back. If you bet on Garcia and he pulls it out somehow, you're getting 20 bucks back on your 10. So you're betting 10, getting back 30. As opposed to betting 10 and getting back 16. So, in the future, just to let you know, what I'm probably gonna do is, is say what I'm gonna bet, right? And then I'm going to just explain the most likely outcome that I think is going to happen. For instance, next week, Triple G's probably gonna win in a 6th to 8th round. However, if I'm putting money, Jacobs is still a 6 or 7 to 1 dog. You know, 10 bucks ain't that much money. Why not put 10 bucks and put it on Jacobs and see if you get 70 back? You know, it's the type of fight where one punch can change anything. And even though I think Triple G is the heavy favorite and he's a better fighter and he's a better technical fighter and all that, you know, we're talking 7 to 1 odds still on a power puncher. So I will do those things from now on. And now here's to the Anthony Joshua stuff. Okay. So Anthony Joshua, want to say he's 19 and 0. 19 knockouts. I don't think he hasn't gone to a decision yet. He's 6'3", about 80-inch reach, give or take an inch. And he's gone he's fluctuated a bit in his career in weight. I believe that he's trying to in the first 15 fights, he was trying to figure out what works best for him. And he started out his career at 229, 230, and then he's gone all the way up to 249, 250. And right now, I think he's settling in about the low 240s range. And that seems to be a good weight for him. He's definitely improved. And we're going to go over those improvements and whatever deficiencies that I seen when I was taking notes. I went through every single fight, made detailed notes on every single fight. It took a long time. But there's no better time to do it because next month we got the Klitschko Joshua fight. So let's get into this. His first fight was against a guy last name Leo. He was undefeated. So Leo was 8-0, and it was a 4-rounder, the only 4-rounder of AJ's career. And that's not bad. Only one 4-rounder. It took him about a minute and a half to settle in. And one of the things that he showed from the beginning of his career was the ability to feint, the ability to try to get through, try to feint his opponent out of position. And he showed that from the beginning. One thing, and he also was jabbing to the body and he was countering off his left hook. So he had a very active front side. Like I like to say, a very active front side, and tall fighters, big fighters need to have that active front side. So one deficiency, a couple of deficiencies that I seen was in mid combination, his hands were low. This is something that you're going to see all the way up until 18 fights in. So his hands aren't coming back to his face when he's throwing punches and when he has his man on the defensive. His hands are not coming back to his hands, they in the beginning of his career, they like to stay at about chest high, mid combination, and that's dangerous. So there was that. And he got hit with two right hands while his left hand was at his chest. So, you know, he paid the price for that very early. And you know, just understand, I'm not being critical of AJ in any way. I'm not biased toward Wilder because I'm American. I'm just saying, you know, I'm nitpicking here. Okay, we're talking about a world-class fighter, a gold medalist that's the best heavyweight champ in the world. And, you know, I'm nitpicking stuff because, you know, when you get to the Wilders or when you get to whoever's going to be good in 3 years, maybe a Joseph Park or whoever, what's going to happen is someone might capitalize. Somebody might, you know, capitalize on one of the things that he does that he doesn't do well. So, you know, what I'm trying to do is forecast what could happen later on. But in all likelihood, he's going to be the best heavyweight in the world for a long time to come. So he wasn't cutting off the ring either. And he got hit with two right hands while his hands were low. But he showed some nice things, and he didn't look like a first fight fighter. He looked good. Second fight, he looked a lot more filled out. And the evidence of that would be that he weighed in at 236. Now, he brought into this fight a nice check hook. This was the first time I'd seen it from him. A nice check hook. And the difference between the counter left hook that he landed in the first fight was that was off of his back foot. Okay, that was a retreating left hook. Something that he just landed while on his back foot. The check hook is a type of hook that you land and it looks like you're going backwards, but what you're actually doing is you're supposed to pivot as your opponent is coming toward you. And you're pivoting off that front foot. And if you want to check out a video, check out the Mayweather-Hatton ending. You pivot off that front foot so that way you can maneuver and let your opponent fall as you hit him with that hook. So you're not only hooking, but you're pivoting and getting into an advantageous position to do more damage after the hook. So that was the first time I seen the check hook from him. I caught him bringing his jab back low again. But what I seen was, you know, good hand speed, great power, combos. Just basically the same thing. You know, his hands came back low again. He did a counter back foot hook, so he's checking and he's doing the counter off the back foot, the hook. And that was nice. Now, something else he did, first time I seen it, was he showed a lot of head movement. Showed a lot of head movement while looking for an opening at the end of the first round. What you would expect from a European fighter and from a taller fighter like Anthony Joshua is for him to stand tall. He was actually moving his head looking for openings. And that was kind of good to see. And he did an interesting combination in this fight. He feinted and then went hook to the body, jab, right hand. So he feinted, then hook to the body, jab, right hand. That's a nasty combination. With the power and speed that he has, that is a nasty combination. And it shows that he was thinking in there. Because that's not the type of combination. Like, it shows that he's working on different stuff in training camp. He's not just throwing punches. He's working on stuff in training camp. That is not a natural combination to throw. Especially with the feint before and a lead left hook to the body. So, you know, he basically threw a 1, 2, 3. So he basically threw, I don't know, this guy. Yeah, so that was cool to see. That was really cool to see. His opponent was 14-19. Fight was scheduled for 6. So now, this is why that combination was good. Because I have it written down. Butlin, whatever, whoever that guy is, he was probably looking for a jab because AJ had been jabbing. And then he's feinting with it. So the hook surprised him. And because of the feint, it just opened up the rest of the combination. Like I said, it was a really good combination. I made a note to write that down. It was just really good stuff to see. Now, third fight. This dude's name starts with a K. Kisichik. He was 5-6. Fight scheduled for 6. AJ went back to 229. So there's his first weight fluctuation. There's going to be more of that. The important note about this next guy is that he went 6 rounds with Tyson Fury. I want to say the fight went to a decision. Now, AJ in this fight threw the check hook after a half step back. So he takes the half step back, he check hooks, and then he pivots. That was really nice. That was the first time I had seen that. I'm going to be notifying you of the stuff that I see, like the first time stuff. And the half step back with the check hook means that he's already maintaining range. He's already got a concept of what range he wants to fight at. Because if he didn't take that half step back, he probably wouldn't have landed the hook. So he already knows what his range is and what he wants to do with that range. So that's really nice to see from him. And of course, I headed down the next note. Looks to be more cognizant of range and using feet for defense. So he threw nasty hooks to the body in this fight. The first time I had seen him throw nasty hooks to the body, multiple ones, while this guy was on the ropes. Now, he was hit with a nice right hand in this fight. And it was because he didn't keep his hands up. Like I said, these guys that are 5-6 and 14-19, they're clipping him with shots. You know, what if that's a world-class fighter with world-class power? And that's what I'm talking about. You know, I'm not trying to be overly critical, but, you know, in a fight that's worth millions of dollars and, you know, your pound for pound, or not your pound for, your heavyweight crown is at stake, you know, you don't want to make those mistakes. So, let's see what else I have. Now, he made a mistake. He got, after he got hit, he was anxious to do damage. And he smothered his own work against the ropes. Now, this is a good move that he did. He jabbed, half-step back, counter right hand. That's the first time I had seen that. And he also did a 1-2-3 combination, landed. His first time. I made a note that he was very sharp in this fight. So, the next fight. I wrote that he was not as cut for this fight. He was kind of stockier. And I looked at his weight on BoxRec. He was 241. So he had a 12-pound weight gain in just a few months from his last fight. The guy he's fighting is 7-2. So, as I said, the last fight, he knows his effectiveness is in the mid to outside range. So he's jabbing and maintaining distance with little half step forward, little half steps back, all dependent upon what his opponent is doing. So you could see that this was a better opponent. He was coming up short early with punches, so he was trying to settle in. Punches weren't landing. And then his opponent slipped a jab and then landed a right hand over the low left. So in the first fight, I believe he was jabbing and not bringing his hand back to his face. He was bringing it to his chest. And his opponent took advantage of that. He slipped the jab, and when the jab hand came back low, he landed a right hand over the low left. So, once again, that's a common theme with AJ. That happened. Another thing, he moved straight back instead of pivoting. You know, it happened one time, but I made a note on that. Now, when he had his opponent in trouble in this fight, he threw no body shots. You know, you want to work the body. You want to make sure that you crush his body when you got him on the ropes. If the headshots ain't landing, don't expect the ref to just jump in and help you. You want to throw to the body. The body will be exposed. Now, he threw a jab to the body and then an uppercut to the body. But his right was low. So it was a nice combination. He went jab, then uppercut to the body. But his right hand was low during that combination. But I did like that. You know, I did like that combination. He's throwing some nice combinations, let me tell you. Now, in this fight against Hector Avila, weighed in at 238, he pivoted, threw a counter left hook, and then a right hand. That was the first time I seen that particular combination and that particular defense to offense move. So he's clearly working on stuff and adding little pieces to his game in training camp at this time. He's not plateauing, he's ascending as a fighter. He's clearly doing work in training camp and working hard. And that's a really good thing to see from a heavyweight. From a young heavyweight that's a gold medalist. He has every reason in the world to coast, you know, or to get by on his talent. But he's clearly maintaining discipline in training camp. This is a good thing. Now, his next opponent, Matt Legg. L-E-G-G. He was 7-2. AJ weighed in at 236. This guy was a squatter. Wanted to fight really low. And AJ had some difficulty adjusting to the awkward movement. Another right hand landed over a low left. Up to this point, this is the best opponent that he had faced. Leg landed a clean left hook. Clean left hook. And it clearly got his attention. AJ's attention. But AJ showed a good chin and fired back immediately. That's important. That's showing off your championship pedigree. You don't want to let the guy get one on you. You want to make sure that he knows that you're in charge. So he showed that championship pedigree. And as soon as he got stunned, or whatever you want to say, you know, when he felt that shot, he came back immediately. Now, against this squatting opponent, he was doing the earmuffs. Earmuffs are here. AJ came in with a right uppercut. Real nice. When that was the first time I had seen him land an uppercut to the chin on someone, so I wrote that down. And what I had written down was that this was a difficult opponent, but he made the correct adjustment. You know, when you watch the fight, you see that the guy's squatting, and AJ just started picking him apart. He started going up the middle on him and that peekaboo defense. He started going to the body. He started pivoting, because if a guy's squatting, his lateral movement isn't going to be as naturally. Even if they were the same talent level, the squatting opponent might not have the type of lateral movement that you would. So Anthony Joshua really showed good angles against that type of opponent. So that's what I mean about making the correct adjustment against that particular guy. Seventh pro fight, he fights a guy named Matt Skelton. I've heard of him before. Matt Skelton has fought for world titles before. He's a guy that's been on the scene in the UK forever. 28-8. AJ came in just under 240 at 239. Another six rounder. Matt Skelton was his best name opponent yet. And one of the things that I had written down was Skelton almost landed a counter right over a lazy jab, but the foot speed kept AJ away versus a more skilled opponent, he may have been hit. So once again, you know, you get a guy that's better, that's world class, that has a maybe a longer reach, that's a little bit taller. Your feet aren't going to be able to get you away from that shot. So you just want to make sure that you're exercising good technique in there and keeping those hands up. He landed a nice uppercut to the body, but the left was away from his face again. Now, he landed a counter right at mid-range. I said it was very nice. It was the first time I had seen him utilize the counter right from that particular distance and without the half step back. So sometimes he's taking a half step back when he's countering. Like I said, he's maintaining distance. He's taking a half step back and then going a half step forward sometimes with the counter punches. So what that says to me is that he's more confident in the pocket. Not every time, you know, it's not every time that he's taking a half step back. So he's confident in the pocket. And he really got scouting reacting to 1-2 feints. That was the first time I had seen that. So he's feinting twice, 1-2. So he's not only feinting the lead jab, he's feinting the lead right as well. So this time, he got scouting out of there by varying the right hand angle and made it land after missing it. So he missed the first right hand, and then he varied the angle on it, and then landed it again. So Skelton made a good defensive move, and then Joshua came back, same hand, landed the shot, but he varied the angle on it. So he's using good improvisation. That's the first time I had seen him use an improvisation on a punching angle, and he had him really reacting to the straight punch feints beforehand, like I mentioned earlier. So once again, he's thinking in there, and he's able to keep his body. He's able to keep his body reacting the same speed as his mind in there. You know, boxing, in other words, boxing is coming is natural to him at this point. Now, against this next guy, the check hook is tighter. It's not as loopy. It's a really tight punch, that check hook. He's getting really good at it eight fights in. I want to say this is about a year, 14 months in his career right now. This is against a guy named Konstantin Erich, 21-9. First 8-round fight. Now he set up the straight right hand up top from the jab to the body. That's the first time I've seen him do that. And I just wrote down good thinking on it. Now, the uppercut after the right hand. So he varied the hook angle this time and made it an uppercut. It was a last second adjustment. When he threw the punch, it was kind of a uppercut slash hook, and he varied the angle on it to make it land in mid-punch, mid-form. So, once again, he's doing work in there. And I noticed something that I kind of foreshadowed before. He would rather use his feet than parry. So he would rather move out of the way than block a punch, which kind of speaks to his thoughts, or his it kind of speaks to where he is on hand placement at this particular time. Now, this particular time he used body shots for the KO, so that was nice to see. So he's putting, little by little, he's adding stuff to his game. Okay, now I'm going to fast forward a little bit, and we're going to fast forward a little bit and go to Kevin Johnson. Kevin Johnson is the biggest name opponent. This is his 13th fight. This is best opponent so far. Their best name, at least. The guy who's fought the best competition. And, you know, the main thing I had on here was that AJ had him in trouble three times and threw two body shots combined. And those three times that he... In those three times that he had this guy hurt, he threw only two body shots combined. That's unacceptable. Once again, you know, if you have a guy in trouble, if you have a guy in trouble, you can get him out of there the first time if you throw body shots. But, you know, also, his heaviest weight up to that point was 248.5. So, you know, he looked kind of clunky in there, but... Once again, I'm nitpicking. So, but yeah, Kevin Johnson, he handled him with ease. Next fight, he comes in at 249.5. This is for a regional heavyweight title, 12-round fight. First 12-round fight of his career. And his check hook at this point is sharp. It got better last time, 2 minutes ago, 3 minutes ago when I mentioned it. But now it's even tighter. And that check hook is right now at a world-class level in his 14th professional fight. Now, in this fight, this is against a guy named Gary Cornish. 21-0. Is that right? Yeah, 21-0. He fought a dude 21-0 in his 14th, you know, very nice. He... threw a nice counter right. He sat in a pocket, gave the shoulder, and then threw a counter right. So it's almost like he looked off the punch, gave him the shoulder, bang. First time I seen that from him. So yeah, like he did do one mistake where he, you know, at this point his hand placement is still a work in progress. However, that counter right hand was really nice. Now, Dylan White. I'd say this is his best opponent up until that point. So he's clearly getting better, clearly fighting better opposition. I want to say Dylan White, like there was a really bad blood going into this fight and both guys are chomping at the bit to get each other. And he was kind of wild in the beginning of this fight. He eventually settled down, but I want to say Dylan White was kind of in his head a little bit. He was wide with his shots. He wasn't as crisp. Like, against other guys, he was crisp and just thinking in there.